Professor Sugata Mitra, who was actually here the first time. I didn't know this myself, because I somehow thought that Professor Mitra had been here before, when the university started, or before it started. But I was really delighted that he's come here all the way, he's taken time out. And the fact that Professor Sugata Mitra is a founding professor, the trip become very special for all of us. So a very warm welcome to Professor Mitra, Sugata as I call him affectionately. Professor Mitra has been so active in the area of so many spaces that he's active in, education technology, pedagogy, cognitive space, children's education, school education. It's very hard to talk about all his accomplishments. But let me be brief here, introducing our founding professor, Professor Sugata Mitra. I would like to start by sharing with all the students today, when the university started, years ago, I think 5 years back, I think early 2002, 2003 time frame, when the core team and Professor Epi Kapoor were there that time, when they started discussing about the university, Professor Sugata Mitra was one of the key minds that advised the founder of the university. I know that, and I've heard that from hundreds of people, because the Hywel experiment, the hole in the wall experiment, was actually something that came from Professor Sugata. He was, if you call him the founder, or call him the person that started the whole revolution, the hole in the wall. Professor Sugata Mitra is currently professor of education technology at the School of Education, Communication and Language Sciences at this beautiful place called Newcastle upon Tyne in UK. He is the founding professor of NIIT University, so therefore, as I said, it's a very special and important occasion for us that he's here today. He's the chief scientist emeritus at NIIT Limited. Professor Sugata Mitra is the instigator of the hole in the wall experiment, where in 1999 a computer was placed, as you all probably know, at a kiosk created within a wall in an Indian slum at Kalkaji, Delhi. I think I've never seen that. And children were allowed to freely use it. And I think that opened up a whole, Pandora's box of the new space. The experiment aimed at proving that kids could be taught computers very easily without any formal training. And I think that is something that's worth noting. So Sugata termed this as minimally invasive education, MIE. The experiment has since been repeated at many places. And the HIW, the hole in the wall, experiment in more than 23 kiosks in rural India. In 2004, the experiment was also carried on in Cambodia. Professor Sugata Mitra's interests include children's education, as I pointed out, remote presence, self-organizing systems, cognitive systems, physics and consciousness. The hole in the wall experiment has left a mark on popular culture. Indian diplomat Vikas Swarup read about Professor Mitra's experiment and was inspired to write his debut novel, Q&A. This subsequently went on to become the movie Slumdog Millionaire. And as you all probably know, and those of you who do not know, that the input or the trigger, the foundation of Slumdog Millionaire was really the hole in the wall experiment, which was triggered by Professor Sugata Mitra. Now, I'm not going to leave you, Professor Mitra is a very accomplished person with great achievements, large number of publications, advisory capacity to various governments, companies, universities, schools also, at all the levels. But I want to point out, in the spirit of seamlessness, that he holds a PhD in solid state physics from IIT Delhi. And that is what really excited me when I read way back his bio. See, look at the seamlessness, look at the way he has evolved with time. PhD in solid state physics, I think 99% of people would just stick in solid state and say, oh, everything else is irrelevant. I'm doing exactly what I think is right. But he's evolved with great foundation in mathematics and physics. He moved on to education technology. He moved on to cognitive sciences. He moved on to pedagogy and to various other areas. So it's indeed a great pleasure to have Professor Sugata Mitra amongst us today. I am sure all of us are going to learn from his insights, from his experience today. And I'm sure that Professor Sugata Mitra will come here frequently as the university, year on year, as we make progress in various dimensions. So I'm going to hand over to Professor Sugata Mitra, and once again, it's a great pleasure and a delight to have you today at NIIT University.
Thank you, Professor Sharif. I understand that also going to start a management program shortly. Hasn't yet started.
It started.
Are there any MBA students here? Ah, good, good. So, I want to tell the MBA students something. If you're selling something, then you have to naturally build up a certain expectation. And after that, if you made the sale, and then it doesn't match up to the expectation, then obviously you will not make the next sale. So what Rajiv has just done is a terrible blunder in management. He has raised your expectations over here, after which my talk can only go like this. Anyway, this talk is called The Future of Learning in a somewhat optimistic way. But here is how it goes. Firstly, how many children there are on the planet? If you try searching on the internet, you'll find it's very difficult to calculate. You get all sorts of websites giving all sorts of different numbers. So, how does one figure it out? Well, one easy way to do it is that in any human population, 15% are generally children. So, if there are 6 billion people on the planet, then you can safely assume that there are 1 billion children. Then the question comes, how much money do these children have? How much money do they have access to? That again is almost impossible to work out, but there is a way. You can take the GDP of all different countries, take their populations, take 15% of the population, so you have the number of children, divide the GDP by the number of children, and you have how much money is available per child. If you do that analysis, then you get a triangle like this, a pyramid. And what it shows is that there are about 50 million children in the world who have more than adequate resources. They have much more than what they need in terms of healthcare, education, living standards, etc. Then there are 200 million children after that who have adequate resources. They have enough for a good education, good healthcare, and so on. And then there are 750 million children who have inadequate resources. Not that they don't have anything, but they have less than what they need. And of course, there always is a bottom of the pyramid where, you know, they have nothing. Now, the interesting thing about this pyramid is that it is not something that exists only in developing countries. This is a pyramid which exists in every country on the planet, rich or poor. Only the shape of the pyramid is different in different countries. In the richer countries, the top is heavier, the bottom is narrower. In the poorer countries, the bottom is wider and the top is narrower. So, I'll give you a question. Do we need three kinds of schools for these three kinds of children? And if you look at Delhi, for example, you realize that yes, indeed, we have three kinds of schools. Okay, we have the really rich kind, we have the middle kind, and we have the really poor kind. So, is that necessary? Because it means working out three different economics, three different pedagogies, three different marketing approaches, three different everything. Could there be only one way to do this? Well, a little bit about what children say. This is a pre-adolescent child, I think about 11 years old. In the UK in 2008. And he says, when I need to know something, at the time when I need to know it, I can find out in 5 minutes. So, how would you make him sit in a classroom in the school? This is what he believes. So he says, what am I doing in school? Here is another one, in 8-year-old from northeastern England. Northeastern England is where all the coal used to be, the coal mines. And it all went away because now coal is mined in China. And it's cheaper to mine coal in China and take it to England than to mine it from Newcastle. So the coal industry has gone and this child is saying, my father is an engineer but doesn't have a job. So how do you make that child learn or join an engineering course? We don't have an answer to that question. Then there's the favorite of mine. From an adolescent in 2006. Why should I work hard to be a professor like you when I can earn as much as you by being a bus driver? So, You know, this is ironic end of development. In developed economies, the gap between the rich and the poor is reduced. So when you reduce it, the children stop aspiring. So why should I be a professor? My children will drive a bus. So now how do you get that fellow to come to university? Then on our side, this is from lower middle class schools in Hyderabad. We can't use the computer room when we want, it's not allowed. It's not allowed meaning the principal has made an arbitrary rule. You are allowed at this time to this time, that time to that time. Boys are allowed from 10 to 11, girls are allowed from 11:30 to 12:30 and so on. So whenever he goes, it's not allowed. Then another school, the internet is down because the school didn't pay. So, now mind you might think very sadly, oh, what a poor school. Nothing of the sort. The school had enough money. The principal wanted to build a toilet or improve a toilet. So he decided where to get the budget from. He said, they'll knock out that useless internet facility and build a toilet. So this poor child is saying internet is down, the school didn't pay. So then we have these two problems. On the one hand, with the richer children, we have problems of relevance and aspiration. And that problem remains as much in India as it remains in the United States or the United Kingdom or anywhere. With the richer children. And then with the poorer children, of course, there's the problem of resources. So now back to my old question. Do you need two different kinds of schools then? At the moment we have three different kinds of schools, but do we still need two different schools, two different methods, etc. to address this problem? Or could there be a common solution? A common solution is desirable because it will be cheaper, more replicable and so on. So then, I started off with this sentence that there are places on the planet where because of one reason or the other you cannot build a school, and more importantly where good teachers either cannot go or don't want to go. So it's very easy to imagine that problem. I mean, if I gave you a map of Rajasthan, if you know the area well, you can easily take a pencil and mark out, okay, it will be very difficult to build a school here. It will be very difficult to get a good teacher here, even if I can build a good school, and so on. So, how do we address this problem? And firstly, what are the consequences of this problem? So, in 2007, we did an experiment. What we did was, we took Google Earth, and you look down at Delhi, and you work out a route out of Delhi which avoids all the built-up areas. So you're going deeper and deeper and deeper into rural India. Okay? You find the roads. And then Ritu Dangwal, who you probably met, who's sitting right here, she rented a vehicle along with a friend of hers and drove down this 300 kilometer road. And every time they saw a school, they would stop and they would give a test for English, math and science. Then we brought the data back, totaled up the marks, and plotted it against distance from Delhi. So the distance from Delhi on the x-axis, total marks on the y-axis. And we got this graph. Now, this is a riddle, because these are all government schools. They have approximately the same amount of money, approximately similar infrastructures, approximately similar number of students and teachers. So what would explain why they get worse and worse as we go deeper and deeper into rural India? So you can make lots of hypotheses. I can give you, I mean, you can agree or disagree with several of these hypotheses. What if I made a hypothesis that children get more stupid in villages? Would you tend to agree with that? No, okay, obviously not. There's absolutely no psychological evidence that rural children are more stupid than urban children. Another stupid hypothesis. Smart people leave villages and go and work in towns, leaving all the stupid people behind. Now, anybody agree with that? No, it's still, and you're right. Again, there's no evidence that that happens. So those were not the real answers of blaming the learners, blaming the parents. Where we got the real answer was that if you ask the teachers, would you like to work somewhere else? Then the further away you go from Delhi, the more loudly they say yes. We want to go and work in Delhi. Okay, so teacher, this was a problem of teacher migration. The good teachers, see, now the teachers over here at the bottom, they are applying for jobs in Delhi. Who will get the job? The best of the lot. So the best teachers will move. When the best teachers move, the results go up. So this was the problem of teacher migration causing this degradation in the education quality. So when I went to England in 2006, then I thought here's a good way to check out that whether this is correct or not, because rural England is no different from urban England. Everything is available. So a teacher is unlikely to say, I don't want to work in a village, I want to work in a city. That problem won't be there. So therefore, the rural schools or all schools should have more or less an uniform performance. So their equivalent of school leaving certificate, CBSE, their equivalent is GCSE. So I took all the GCSE results and looked for whether they are uniform and found that they are not uniform at all. There are some very good schools and then there are some very bad schools. So what would explain that in a developed economy where the teachers are so well paid and there are all the facilities everywhere? So after looking for some time, we got the answer. This time on the y-axis are the GCSE marks. On the x-axis is an interesting number. In England, you have something called council housing. Council housing is subsidized government housing. You know, the equivalent of what we would call here resettlement colonies. So if families don't have money, then the government subsidizes the housing. On the x-axis is the density of subsidized housing. That in an area, how much of these resettlement type houses are there and how much regular houses are there. And the higher the density, the lower the school results. So then I thought, now what? Why should high council housing density cause this problem? So I went there to those areas to look. And you find that the schools, you know, are a little bit more dirty. There's paper lying on the ground. There's graffiti written on the walls. If you ask the teachers, they say, no, it's a dangerous area to walk around in the evening. It's not a good idea. And then if you ask them a little bit more, they say, you know, if I could get a job in a less crowded area, I would go away. So same teacher migration problem was there in the developed economy. So then I realized that this problem of places where good teachers won't go is not a developing country or developed country problem. It's a universal problem. Because teachers are human beings and they like to work in good places. So how do you sort this problem out? So that takes us back to 12 years ago, where I was working with NIIT. You know, I worked for many, many years, decades with NIIT, and I was looking after the R&D. And we, one of our jobs was to make courses for you know, software development, which would be taught to children with a lot of money, because they were expensive courses. And right next door is this large slum lying around with children. So now I thought that is there any reason why those children wouldn't make as good software engineers as these children would? So it's only that they can't afford it. And my old problem, I can't get a teacher to go to the slum, because he's going to say, why should I go and teach in the slum? I get paid so much more for teaching in a proper environment. So does it mean that the children won't come to know what a computer is ever? So I tried an experiment in 99, which was simply to put a computer in the slum and see what happens. But that's easier said than done. For those of you who are doing engineering, how do you put a computer in a slum? You can't take a table chair and put the computer there. You can't do that anywhere. I mean, if you take a table chair and put a computer on in Khan Market, it will disappear in 15 minutes. So computers are not meant to be kept outdoors. So where do you keep it? So the only model I could think of was the bank ATM. I said the banks have solved this problem. They can keep computers in open spaces because they built the ATM kind of structure. So Sanjay Gupta, whom you met, built his own do-it-yourself ATM. And this was on the slum wall. We put a computer against it, turned it on, put Internet Explorer, 2 megabits per second, and just left it there. So then everybody in those days said that, what are you trying to do? Some child will come, he'll take a stone, he'll smash it, he'll break the computer, steal the parts and go and sell it in the Kabaddi Bazaar. So this is what everybody was expecting. But that didn't happen. What we found later on was that the children were browsing and they were teaching each other to browse. So this was a big puzzle, like how can this happen? They don't know any English, never seen a computer before. Remember, this is 1999. Never heard of the internet. So how on earth were they able to do this? We didn't have an answer, but people said, well, there could be a simple answer. Maybe one of the NIIT students was passing by and he just showed the children to do it like this. So I thought, well, that's very possible, but then let me try it somewhere very far away. So again, Ritu found a village called Madan Tusi, which was in the Rayabareli district, quite remote. And it didn't have an English teacher at all, for the reasons which I told you, that no good English teacher will go to Madan Tusi to teach English. So the children knew very little English. So we built a hole in the wall computer there, left it there and went to it. So we came back after a couple of months, computer is still intact. Children, as usual, are playing games on it. And as soon as they saw me, I have some footage of that also. These two little children playing with the computer, as soon as they saw me, they said, oh, we need a better mouse. And this processor is very slow. So we said, now how do they know all this? So then it turned out that they had figured it out on their own. They had got it from CDs, all sorts of ways in which they had got it. So then we started to get research funding from the World Bank. Because World Bank got interested that this is too good to be true, that no teacher, nothing, you just put the computer and the children are teaching themselves to use it. So we repeated this almost 17, 18 times, actually 23 times, of which 17 villages were studied. And we took groups, samples in each village, and we studied their improvement in computer literacy over time. And we came to some very interesting conclusions. So here's a glimpse of those years. This is the first day. Rajasthan, that village which you saw, they had discovered the sound recorder and they were singing into it and then listening to their own songs. So all this was happening, and when we measured it, we came to this graph. There's computing literacy on the y-axis, months on the x-axis. So in 9 months, you see that there's this absolutely straight upward graph. And this is a test of computing literacy, where if I took that test and gave it to you right now, you would also get approximately 44-45. This is what the average computer user will get in that test. So it involves browsing, chatting, email, nowadays Facebook, whatever we do. All of that was getting done by itself. And the conclusions were that groups of children can learn to use computers and the internet on their own, irrespective of who or where they were. Now that last line is very important. You can imagine that people like the United Nations loves that last line. So this was saying that you don't need three kinds of schools or you don't need two kinds of pedagogies. At least for teaching computers, there was just this one single one which will flatten the playing field. So at this point, I started to get a little more ambitious that, okay, if they can teach themselves to use computers, What else could they teach themselves? Could they teach themselves other things? The first problem that we got a little bit of funding for came from Hyderabad. In Hyderabad, for those of you who've been there or those who haven't also, Hyderabad is full of tiny little private schools, not for rich children, but for poor children. It's a very strange thing. Thousands of schools called, you know, Little Angels or St. Michael's or something like that, where the poor people pay a few rupees a month to send their children, even though government education is free. The reason? The schools promise to teach good English. And learning good English in that social strata of Hyderabad means a huge difference in the kind of life that they will live later on. So the parents will send their children to Hyderabad to learn English. But the schools would do a good job. They were not cheating. They would do a good job. They would teach good grammar. They would teach good comprehension, reading, spelling. One thing that they could not do, they cannot get native English language speakers to become teachers for the reasons that I told you. Why should a native English language teacher go into the slums of Hyderabad to teach English? So they have to use local Telugu speaking teachers. Now Telugu, any Telugu speakers here? No Telugu speakers here. Well, if there was a Telugu speaker here amongst you, you would realize that Telugu has a very strong accent. Okay? Very, very thick, strong accent. So the children pick up this accent. Then they apply for call center jobs in Delhi or Bombay or something like that. And then the interview board says, well, your English seems to be alright, but I can't understand what you're saying. So how do you get a job? So now here was a problem that teachers can't solve because teachers don't go there. So it has to be solved by technology and nothing else. So what I tried was an experiment. I bought a computer, this was in 2002, and gave it to a school. In the computer I put in speech to text software, you know, which you get for free now with Windows, but those days we had to buy it. The idea is you speak into a microphone, and if the computer understands you, then it will type out what you're saying. So then I called the children, a group of sample children, and said, okay, talk into the computer. So they spoke into the computer typed complete nonsense. So the children then said, it doesn't understand anything. So I said, okay, here is what I'll do. I'll leave this computer here for 2 months, and you make yourself understood. So the children said, how do we make ourselves understood? And that's when I started to get the idea of the new method. Because the only answer I could give them was, I have no idea. And anyway, I'm going away for 2 months. So I went away for 2 months. After 2 months, I came back. And there's this little fellow, Faizan or something like that. It's a predominantly Muslim slum area. So Faizan is standing outside the classroom. So I said to Faizan in English, I said, Faizan, how are you? So Faizan, who's about that high, looks up, says, fantastic. So, my God, what's happened to this school now? So then I went inside and looked at what they had done. Now this is very interesting for those of you who are interested in education. You see, I had left them with a problem. And many teachers will do that. At the end of a lecture, you'll be left with a problem. But you're also left with a pedagogy, a method by which to solve the problem. I had left these children with a problem, but with no method either. Because I said, I don't know how you do it. So what they had done, which was very interesting to me as a teacher, is that they had invented the method. What they had done was, they had downloaded something called the Speaking Oxford Dictionary. Speaking Oxford Dictionary, what it does is that if you type the word, it speaks it out in a proper BBC English voice. They would then use this to construct a sentence. It would speak it out. They would listen. They would speak it back into the text-to-speech. And then see if text-to-speech was producing the right words or not. Fantastic job by 12-year-olds in inventing a pedagogy. Now here is a little glimpse of that.
Yes, he's my cousin.
And then they would sit around in groups, correcting each other's accents. This girl, by the way, is now about 19 or 20 years old, and some of you may know her because she works for a call center in Hyderabad. So you might have spoken to her, trying to sell you a credit card or something. But she made absolutely remarkable progress. So after Hyderabad, I started to get really interested in this subject, saying, this is fantastic that they're not only using the computer, but they can invent a pedagogy by themselves. By the way, all of this is published. The whole sequence of papers which outlines this whole thing. So what do we do with this now? At this point in time, something very interesting happened. Have you heard of the science fiction writer called Arthur C. Clarke? Some of you have. Well, Sir Arthur C. Clarke was still alive at that time, and he was living in Colombo. So he wrote to me and he said that, you know, I've been following your work, and I'm very curious to know what's happening. So I went over to Colombo and I met him. So he said two very interesting things after listening to the whole thing. The first one he said was, a teacher that can be replaced by a machine should be. Think about it today, it's a double twisted sentence. If you cannot be replaced by a machine, no problem. Then you carry on teaching. But if you can be replaced by a machine, then you should be replaced by a machine. The second thing he said was, if learners have interest, then education happens. You don't have to do anything about it. So armed with both of these, we started to experiment, this time outside India, in Cambodia, in South Africa, and everywhere we found evidence that this kind of learning would happen. So here's a glimpse of those years.
This is possible. And they can definitely help people, because the children quickly learn to navigate the wind and find things which interest them. And when you've got interest, then you have education.
This is Nitin. I play games.
Play songs.
Like animals. And I listen to music.
And meanwhile, in the streets of Delhi, almost 8 or 9 months have passed, and the children are busy on all of these computers in Malangir. They still exist. And the school teachers were beginning to say some really interesting things. The school teachers were saying that, you know, the children's standard of English has gone up like anything. And their quality of homework has changed completely. So even I, who is a great optimist, even I found it hard to believe that just sticking computers into walls, how can it have so much effect? So we went off to investigate, Ritu went and all of us went. And what we discovered was very simple. About 6 months down the line, the children had discovered Google. And they were Googling their homework. So naturally the English was perfect. The content was wonderful. Teachers were highly impressed. So I thought, my God, what have I done? This is a monster. Because is this learning? They are just copying it down from Google. Now, I'm going to leave that thought with you, that is it learning or not? Because I would get the answer to that almost 6 years later from a little English child in rural England. We'll come to that in a moment. At that point, we came to this conclusion. Groups of children can navigate the internet to achieve educational objectives on their own. Now, up to this point in time, teachers were very supportive of my work. They used to say, this is wonderful, children are teaching themselves computers, children are changing their pronunciation. When I said they can do educational objectives on their own, the teachers became a little, we don't know, you know, this is, you are really overstating things, they said. So around this time, Newcastle University got a huge research grant, almost £2 million. And coincidentally, the fund was to improve the quality of schooling in India, particularly in Hyderabad. So Newcastle University called me and said, look, you're the man who should be doing this. So as a result of which, of course, with such a huge research project, you never say no. So I pushed off and went to Newcastle. That project, by the way, finished only last year. So when I reached Newcastle and I told them these results in a similar talk with the faculty, then at this point, they put their foot down and they said, look, this is too much. It's one thing to say they can teach themselves computers, it's another thing to say they can teach themselves anything at all. So I said, alright, the only way I know how to prove or disprove things is through an experiment, so why don't we design an experiment to show that there are some things which children cannot teach themselves. We'll get a null, negative result. So that work takes us to the last bit, 2006 to 2010. Starts with an experiment which again Bithu and I did in the village of Kalikupam. And the research question, you find it a ridiculous research question. The research question was, can 12-year-old Tamil-speaking children in a tsunami-hit Indian village teach themselves the biotechnology of DNA replication in English on their own? And I said, well, what a wonderful research question. We will give them a pre-test, they will get a zero. I'll give them a post-test, they'll get a zero. I'll go back to Newcastle and I'll say, we need teachers for certain things. So we went off to Kalikupam. And we downloaded some material into the computers and called the children and said, you know, take a look at this. The usual thing. So the children said, how? This was all English, big word. So I said, I don't know. The usual method. I said, I don't know and I'm going away. So I'll leave it here, I'll come back in 2 months. So Ritu did the pre-testing. Predictably, they got a statistical zero, 3 or 4%. We came back after 2 months, called all the children, they came in very quietly this time. So then we asked them, what have you understood? Oh, nothing. So nothing, no, nothing. How many times did you look at it? Oh, every day we look at it. So then I thought, this is strange. So every day you look at it, you don't understand anything. What is this going on? So then this girl that you see with the pigtails, she raises her hand. And she says, no, structure of DNA, yes. And you know, improper replication of DNA causes genetic disease, those things we have understood. Apart from that, nothing else we have understood. So, now remember the context. 12-year-old Tamil-speaking children with a roadside computer, they're learning biotechnology by themselves. So Ritu post-tested them. And this was the result. It was an educational impossibility. Nothing, you'll not find this in any education book. They had gone from 0 to 30% in 2 months, unattended, in a subject like biotechnology, in a language that was foreign to them. So how can it happen? We still don't know the entire mechanics of the process, but we know that that girl in the pigtails played a big role. As we saw, in the absence of pedagogy, children can invent a pedagogy. In the absence of a teacher, children can invent a teacher. Kalikupam showed that they can get up to 30. But I still couldn't go back to Newcastle. Because 30 is a fail. So it still doesn't serve my purpose. How do I get them the extra marks? So then, Ritu found this, you can't get a biotechnology teacher to go to Kupam. Why should they? So how do we solve that problem? So Ritu found a young girl called Rekha, who basically was a friend of the children, played football with them, that sort of thing. She's about 20, 22 years old at that time and basically an accountant type person working with an NGO. So then we told Rekha, you teach them more biotechnology. So Rekha says, I can't, I didn't have any science in school, I have no idea what this is. So he said, no, what you do is, just be with the children. Every time they do something, you just keep admiring them. Every time they do anything at all, you say, fantastic. Kaise kiya? How did you do this? What a wonderful thing you've done. And do some more, and so on. She did this for about 2 months. The results went up to 50%. There was a control school in Delhi that we were measuring simultaneously, and the two schools were at par by then. By then, the matter had become really serious because this was a serious subject, biotechnology, and they were touching the same levels as a trained teacher by themselves. With what? With a friendly but not knowledgeable mediator. Now that again was a great finding. That everybody knows that a friendly and knowledgeable mediator is what a teacher should be. But the fact that a friendly but not knowledgeable mediator can also be a powerful learning instrument was shown in Kaliputra. So then I could go back to England. And I went back to England to a school in a little city called Gateshead. So in this Gateshead school, I took a class of 32 children. And now here's the method. Went into the class, I told them, okay, make yourselves into groups of four. I don't know who your friends are, so you make your own groups of four. So they made eight groups of four. I said, well, the rules are, you can talk as much as you like within the group. You can talk across groups from one group to another. If you want to join another group, you can go and join another group. If you want to go and see what another group is doing, look over their shoulder, then come back to your own group and pretend that you have found it yourself. That's also allowed. So they all liked all these rules very much. And after that, I said, okay, now I'm going to give you six CBSE exams, or GCSE exams, the equivalent of CBSE. So remember, these are 10-year-old children. So these are questions they will see 6 years later. So I gave them these six questions, and I said, okay, now you do what you like. The best group got all six questions right in 20 minutes. The worst group in 45 minutes. So the teachers came back. I had taken the teachers out. The teachers came back and said, so what? So I said, what do you mean, so what? I said, you know, I mean, what are you trying to show? They have used Google, they have used Wikipedia, they have used Ask Jeeves, Answer Back, and they have answered the question. So what is the big deal? What are you trying to show? So I said, do you mean that they haven't learned then? They said, no, because they have not been taught. I said, alright, then we will check this out. Let's design another experiment. So I came back to the same school after 2 months. This time I made all the children sit in rows and columns like you're sitting. I said, no computers, no talking. Here are the six GCSE questions, you answer them on paper, like you would when you are sitting for your CBSE exam. The answer. Now here's a great riddle. When I did it the first time, the average group score was 76%, which is fantastic for 10-year-old children answering GCSE questions, but then using Google, using everything. When I gave it to them the second time on paper, where they didn't have access to anything other than themselves, the average score, strangely enough, was 76%. So this was a surprise. Everybody was expecting it to drop a little bit. It didn't drop, it was 76%. So then I asked the teachers, how can this happen? So the teachers said, you know what's happened? These children remember what they saw on their computer with photographic clarity, and they're just reproducing the same language because they have discovered it themselves. And now I know that even 2 years later, if you give them the same question, they'll still answer it properly. So then I asked the teachers, and we were discussing it amongst your faculty this afternoon over lunch, that we don't know really what learning is, but our only measure of learning is the ability to answer an examination. If that is your measure, then these children are at 76% from zero. So they have learned whatever you wanted them to learn. If we want to change our definition, that's a different matter. But at the moment, the whole world defines education as, if you get pass marks in CBSE, it means you don't need to go to school anymore. So that's what it is. So then, these groups of four method, then I can solve their educational objective on their own. But we know that it will not go beyond 30%. How do we know that? Because of Kaliputra. We know that you can go up to about 30, after that, on your own, you stop. So what do you need at that point? You need a friendly but not knowledgeable mediator. Where do you get these from? I decided that amongst us in our society, we have one friendly but non-knowledgeable mediator always present. We have always had it all our lives, every generation has had it. They are the grandparents. And even if the grandparents are knowledgeable, they always pretend that they are not. They will always say, "Arey baap re, kaise kiya, what wonderful grandchildren I have, and fantastic, you will do very well in life, do some more, do some more." And the child, in order to show off to the grandparents, will go into a learning spiral. So I decided that if I have to use this method, I need to add into it one more component, a grandmother. Now, where to get grandmothers from? So I put out an appeal in the Guardian newspaper saying, if you are a British grandmother and if you have broadband at home with a web camera, then I want 1 hour of your time every week for free. And I got 200 volunteers, of whom 40 qualified. They had the right equipment and everything. And over the last 2 years, these 40 women have covered more than 800 hours of instruction inside the slum schools of Hyderabad. In Newcastle, it's called the Granny Cloud. And whenever they're needed, the Granny Cloud is beamed into the slum schools of Hyderabad. The whole method is called the self-organized learning environment. And here are a few glimpses of it. This is what a self-organized environment looks like.
You can't catch me! You said, you can't catch me. I'm the gingerbread man. Well done, very good, so we get.
In the meanwhile, the gate said,
our spirit should please stay in.
This little girl explaining Hinduism.
In Sanskrit, means a thought or a place which is difficult to
when into portal and we typed in here. We went into portal and
we typed in here. So by now it was becoming evident that here was a method. Here was a method which perhaps can level the playing field without having to build three kinds of schools. But how far can that method go? So I just show you two little examples and then I stop. I went to Italy in last year and worked in an Italian school in Turin with 30 10-year-olds. And I told the teachers, after telling them all this story, I told them, can you leave the room? I'll work with them. So the teachers said, look, this is not going to work. Because you don't know a word of Italian and the children don't understand a single word of English. So I said, well, we'll see what to do. So what I started doing was on the whiteboard, I wrote down a question in English. How did dinosaurs die out? I had already made them into groups of four. So the children looked at the question. They said, can't understand anything. So I said, look, you have to answer question. So I said, well, shall I bring teachers back? So they said, no, we will understand everything. So you know the situation. So then after that, what they did was, they typed in the English sentence into Google Translate, got the Italian sentence, typed that into Italian internet, and got the answer. And then I got quite excited looking at this, so I started making the questions harder and harder to see what would happen next. So here's a glimpse of that. Dinosaur extinction out there in 20 minutes. Next one was where is Calcutta, which was really simple for them. They just took 10 minutes to do it. So now I got really ambitious and gave them a really hard one. These are 10-year-olds. But who was Pythagoras and what did he do? Now that's being really cruel to 10-year-olds. This time there was silence. So after some time, one of them comes up to me and says, you've spelled it wrong.
Yeah.
20 minutes later, the right angle triangles came. So it was quite evident that they wouldn't stop. Another, if I had given them another 30 minutes, they were typing in Pythagoras' equation into Google. Google was taking them into condensation of space and time. And they were heading straight into, they don't know where to stop. So they're going straight inside. Teachers came back and said, should you not stop them? And I said, no, that's what I was trying to say, that this is the 21st century. I don't know if I should stop them or whether I should just let them go. That question you have to answer. Here's Melbourne. I'll tell you the context of the problem. In Melbourne, you have Aborigine children and you have white children. And there's a school where both of them work together. There is a social stigma which says the Aborigine children will always do worse than the white children. Obviously, I didn't like hearing that at all. So I said, well, let's use my method and see, we should be able to clearly see what the difference is between the two. So I gave them a really hard question, again 9-10 year olds, what are ions? And this is what happened. Determines what the charge on the ion is, etc. Incredible enough. But did you notice another thing? The girl who can speak English clearly was picked to speak English. Remember, this is unsupervised. The Aborigines know how to draw. The Aborigine girl had converted that into a diagram, and their plan was she will hold up the diagram and this girl will read. So I showed that, and the teachers, you know, they were really moved at that time. And I said, you see this in front of your eyes. The playing field is level. So what's the sum total of this conclusion? I think this is what a new primary education curriculum ought to be. First, information search and analysis skills. By the way, NIIT has a deep history inside that. There's a professor called J.R. Isaac who used to work with us, Professor Emeritus of Computer Science, IIT Bombay. He had coined this term at least 20 years ahead of his time. The internet was barely there at that time, so I give complete credit for the first one to Professor J.R. Isaac. Information search and analysis skills. The second thing, very important, for all of you, for all children, reading comprehension. The ability to read a passage and clearly understand what it's trying to say. And third thing, a rational system of belief. Because when you're sitting in front of the internet, you don't have a teacher. When you have a teacher, you leave all the ethics to the teacher. You expect that the teacher will teach you the right thing. The internet doesn't do that. So you have to make up your mind whether what you are reading is right or what you are reading is wrong. In order to do that, there is only one way to do it. You cannot go by faith. You can only go by reason. Cross-check, cross-referencing, peer assessment. That's a rational system of belief. If we can teach children these three things, I think we can just let them go. And everything else will happen. So what does this all mean in terms of science? I think what we've stumbled across since those days of 1999 is a self-organizing system. Self-organizing system is one where the system structure appears without explicit intervention from outside. Chemists have known this for years. You put in this, you put in that, you shake the test tube a little bit and the structure begins to come. Who made the structure? Nobody made it, it just happened. That's self-organizing system. And these structures which come out, they are called emergent phenomenon. This subject is studied in chemistry, studied in physics, studied in math. an emergent phenomenon, the appearance of a property which is not previously observed as a functional characteristic of the system, which is why you react with surprise and say, oh my God, how did this happen? Because there was nothing in the system which said that that should have come. You know, like here in Rajasthan, you have a bit of dust lying there, it's a windy day, the dust is flying around, and suddenly it forms a spiral and starts moving around. That's emergent phenomenon. And you say, gosh, can it think? It seems to know where it's going. So I've left this as a speculation. I don't want you to believe this because it's pure speculation. But could it be that education is a self-organizing system where learning is the emergent phenomenon? And I think it will take about a lab and 5 years to actually show whether this is so or not. And in that understanding, if we can understand it, will lie a physics of education. And that probably will be the future of learning. Okay, thanks for listening. So I think we have just about a few minutes, very few minutes, but if there are some one or two questions or comments or anything else. Think fast. See, if you were 9-year-olds, if I put them into this sort of situation and say, yeah, go ahead. You have a question? Did somebody say they had a question? Well,
I'll probably ask. I'll start a question.
Okay.
Something that we discussed over lunch too. So Ratha, I'm just curious, something that bothers us, probably as students will intently hear us. I think today's children, students included, I mean, they're too influenced by internet. Now, I'm myself an internet product and I'm working in the area. But I have a problem with that. The fundamentals are not in the internet. The peripheral riffraff is there. By riffraff, I mean data. To me, data and information is not knowledge. I see a huge gap emerging in today's population. What is your answer to that? I may be wrong, but correct me if that's
well. I as a teacher also have entirely similar question in my mind, and you as students should in fact think about this, that what does deep learning mean? I mean, when you look at a child who is saying something fantastic, when a child who is saying the number of protons minus the number of electrons is the charge, you might react by saying, but has she really learned anything? But people have asked this for millennia. Each generation seems to believe that the previous generation knew a little bit more about the fundamentals than the present generation does. You know, just think across to what our fathers used to say and what our grandfathers used to say. They would also say, in my time, we used to focus on the fundamentals. Every generation seems to say this. So then I begin to suspect, is there a problem with the definition of fundamental? But having said that, the other part of your question about the internet, you know, the problem with the internet is unimaginably large. It is just beyond all human imagination. So when you say the fundamentals are not there, I tend to immediately go on guard. And I say, is there anything that you can say is not there on the internet? Can you say it with certainty? If I type into a good quality search engine, I want a clear understanding, a deep understanding of Newton's third law of motion. Who is to say that there isn't one piece of video on YouTube, one piece of writing by Feynman, which is sitting somewhere up there, which will teach me that? The problem is not that. The problem is, do we want to learn that fundamental or not? Because everything else is so easy, you don't want to learn it. You know, you don't want to learn it. So if I give you a chemical equation and ask you to balance it, you just find a tool and you balance it using the tool. If I then tell you, but you didn't really understand what you were doing, you would, like that 12-year-old, you will say, but do I need to? This is a question, actually, it's unfair putting it to you as students. This is a question that we as teachers have to address. this is the new curriculum, the new way of dealing with teaching. And I guess there are a couple of PhDs sitting over there waiting to be done on this kind of a subject. Anything else?
Would you say that the evolution of teaching itself was an aberration? Because, let me add something.
Okay.
Because, when I was listening to it, it's obvious that in the prehistoric days, everybody learned by observation and group learning. There's nobody to teach. Caveman learned that way, and people studied nature and drew their own conclusions.
Yes.
So, was there a need for teachers at all at any point in time?
Well, now that you raise it, not to be believed by a controversial point of view, which is to say that I don't know if teachers were needed or not, but I know this much, I think I know this much. Teaching was invented for warfare. You know, remember from the old times, what was our father of physics, Aristotle, what was Aristotle used for to train Alexander? Why did the Victorians invent this method of spare the rod and spoil the child? Here is the curriculum, you sit in straight lines and rows and columns, we will teach you physics, chemistry, mathematics. If you don't do your homework, we will beat you. Why did they invent a method like that? Because their requirement was different. Their requirement was, 3 months from today, we need 400 soldiers in Ghana. Produce them by whatever means you can. Teachers were left with no choice but to use the stick. Pavlovian condition. There was no other way to do it. Unfortunately, those days of the empires have gone away, but the teaching methods haven't changed. That could be a partial answer to your question, that which actually puts education in a very bad light, that teaching was the ultimate weapon of war. To further amplify this, all you need to do is to walk in through the immigration in the United States, and when they ask you what do you do, just say I'm a nuclear physicist.
That's it.
Well then, if you don't have any more questions, we will be absolutely delighted to see your beautiful campus here. And I hope you have a great time, get yourself a good degree and get yourself a good job eventually. Okay? And if you want to come to Newcastle, you're always welcome. It's a city which is 5 miles by 5 miles and has 1,000 pubs.
Well, I'd like to add a piece of information here. I heard Professor Mitra for the first time in 2009 in IIT Delhi, at 1999 IIT Delhi. And at that time, the story of the hole in the wall was absolutely spellbinding. I must say that 12 years down the line, this story of the way education experiments have been conducted in all parts of the world is probably even more spellbinding. I'm sure you all share with me that it has been a great afternoon for us, a great lecture, totally original, totally innovative, and indeed various questions that all of us should think about, particularly as teachers. I've thought about it many times, and I've talked about this hole in the wall to many, many people so far. I've been there a lot, sir. But I think we all must thank Professor Mitra in the depth of our hearts for bringing to us this incredible technique that he and his team have been employing to understand education. Thank you very much.
Kindly give it a memento. Thank you. Thank you.